church is one foundation, is Jesus Christ her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the word. From him he came and sought her.
Our Heavenly Father, we're thankful to you for today. We're grateful to you for every day that you give to us. We're grateful to you for the measure of health that you provided for us, for the things that we need to survive, and the many, many things you've given to us that just make life pleasant. Thank you, Father, for all these things, and we pray that you would continue to bless us, because we realize that every blessing in our life comes from you. Father, we thank you most especially for Jesus and for all the riches that he's brought into our lives. We're thankful to you this particular moment for your word that teaches us about Jesus, helps us to see him more clearly, helps us to understand his teachings. And Father, we pray that you would help us as we do study to do more than simply add to our knowledge. Help us to add to our wisdom and understanding so that we might in every way become more like him in our words, our thoughts, our deeds. Our Father, we come before you and we ask for your forgiveness of our sins, and we confess that we oftentimes do fall short. But help us, Father, to always repent of those things, to turn back to you, to correct our lives. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Well, last time we just were kind of finishing up chapter 14. We had taken a look at these parables that Jesus had taught, starting in verse 28. He gives two parables. One of them is about building a tower, building a foundation, and then not being able to finish it. And he also ends up comparing following him to a king that's about to go to war, who is most assuredly going to count up his soldiers, count up how many guys the other guy has, and then come to some sort of a conclusion about whether it is that he should actually go to war, counting the cost. And so it is important for us, as we've kind of talked about, to be sure to count the cost of following Jesus. It's not always going to be easy. There are things that we will, in some cases, need to forfeit. There are things that we'll need to turn away from. And this is basically the way that Jesus is showing us. You have to give Jesus credit for so many different things, but one of the things you have to give him credit for is not painting a sunshine and roses picture about following him. It's going to be difficult, without a doubt. That being said, then, he does go on to talk in verse 34 about the about salt. And again, this is something of a parable, I guess you could say. Luke chapter 14, verse 34. Therefore salt is good, but if salt has become tasteless, with what will it be seasoned? It is useless either for the soil or for the manure pile. It is thrown out. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. This particular parable is... Yes, sir. So what is he trying to say when he says that we're like salt?
Salt, S-A-L-T.
S-A-L-T, yeah.
Spice.
That's true. What is salt used for?
Cooking.
What else? What's that?
Preserving
things. It's good for all those things. Yes, sir.
Salt per se does not lose its flavor, but it loses the ability for you to taste it when it gets impurities in it, waste material, sediment, dirt, whatever. Mm-hmm. When it reaches that point, it is good for nothing. And we are good for nothing when we let all of these things come into our lives when salt reaches the point that you can't taste salt, can't bring it back, you can't put it in your flower bed, you can't put it in your garden because it'll destroy. So it's good for nothing but to be cast out and trod underfoot.
Yeah. So if we are salt, and it is possible, as is implied here, that you can lose your saltiness, what is Jesus trying to say to us?
Salt is like discipline ship to God. It's like your allegiance to the Lord.
Yeah.
Is what it's related. It's what it's symbiotic. It's a symbiotic thing, I guess.
Yeah. No. Yes, sir.
Well, back in that day and time, they didn't have purified salt like we have. We go down this 4-year container, there's nothing there but salt. The salt they had was what they mined. And it would come out and it would add dirt with, you know, other minerals with it. And it would interact with those minerals and lose its saltiness. It wouldn't be salty anymore because it interacted with all those other minerals that were in the combination. And so it's like we are in the world. We're out here in the world and we're in, mixing around with worldly people. We're going to lose our saltiness if we don't watch out.
Right. And so that's kind of the point here. Yes, sir?
Salt is the chemical for salt is floating.
Sodium chloride, most of the time. Yeah. So,
the salt is in everything, right? All foods, most of all foods.
Most of the time it's added there. Y'all?
Yeah, I think one other thing Jesus was talking, trying to bring to our attention, because when we further look, he says we should portray to the world so that the world will see who we are, to glorify God. Therefore, as we are Christians, we come into Him, just like the lady said, we have an allegiance with Him. We need to bring it up. Not just being in the church and being and saying, I am a Christian, and that's all you have. But you have to portray, bring the love, all the Matthew 5 thing, bring it all into it. So, glorify God.
Right. So, what he's trying to say then is that we need to not be deluded, I guess you could say, in our discipleship. And all these worldly things can in fact do that. Now, looking at verse 33, because we kind of skipped over 33 real briefly, he says, so that none of you can be my disciple who does not give up all his own possessions. And it's kind of an interesting word here for give up. It is the word apotosomai, and basically it means to say goodbye to. Say farewell to.
Hasta luego.
Yeah. So he's trying to tell us that we just need to be very careful about some of these things that really can pollute our lives, dilute what it is that we're trying to be as Christians. Because if we're not careful, we can, I suppose, carry the name Christian without really being a disciple of Jesus. Yes, sir.
This reminds me of an old story about a young man writing his girlfriend to tell her just how much she meant to him. You know, dear Sally, I want you to know just how much I love you. I would climb the highest mountains to get to you. I'd cross the widest deserts. I'd swim the largest oceans. I'll see you, P.S., I'll see you Saturday night if it doesn't rain.
Yep. Yep. And sometimes that's kind of the way that we are. We express all kinds of love and adoration toward the Lord, and yet sometimes there are things that get in the way that are really pretty minor. And that's really the whole idea that we're taking a look at here in terms of discipleship. And the cost of discipleship. Just knowing and realizing that sometimes there are sacrifices that will be made, or that need to be made at least, so that we don't get surprised, I guess, when those things happen.
In context, he's already talked about you have to give up your father, mother. You have to. Who does not carry his own cross and come after me? And now he's talking about possession. So it is the scope of everything in order to be a disciple is kind of one of the larger points that we need to remember.
Yeah, definitely. And it is worthwhile asking this last question. What is the taste in this parable? What is the taste in this parable?
Taste?
Mm-hmm.
What is the taste of
life? Well, Jesus says that we're salt. We should be salt. But he says, but even if salt has become tasteless, with what will it be seasoned? What is the taste here? Let me ask a question this way. To the world, do you taste like a Christian?
Yes.
We should. What would that mean in a practical sense, to taste like a Christian?
Obeying God's
word. Yeah. That's a good generic way of putting it. What are some of the details? Yes, sir.
They know where to find you on Sunday morning.
They'll know where to find you on Sunday morning. Yep. What else?
Just the things that you do and see, or your attitude towards people.
Yeah, exactly. The attitude you might have toward people, the kind of words that you might end up using, right? The kind of behavior when everybody else is doing this, we're all going out to the bar, you're doing that, going home or going to visiting someone or doing something good. We need to be sure that we're not putting our light under the bushel basket, as it were. We need to make sure that we're not trying to hide the flavor of Jesus from the world, because that's really what we're here for. Part of what it is that we're to be doing is that we're to be like Christ. It's not by accident that the church is also known as the body of Christ. You ever thought about that? What that might mean?
It is the church.
Jesus is no longer here in the flesh. But the church is called his body. There are some theologians that refer to the church as the second incarnation of Christ. And I don't think that's a bad identification. What it is that we're supposed to be doing as Christians and as a church is to be like Christ to the world. Now, of course, we don't have the ability to do miracles and we haven't got the authority to make up the rules. Jesus has all that authority exclusively. But in terms of living a Christian life and showing Christ to the world through our words, through our actions, through our attitudes, through everything that we do, that's kind of our job. Yes?
Our actions are our deeds.
Right. Exactly. All right. Any other thoughts about being salt? Counting the cost? And let's go on to chapter 15. What's that?
Salt and sugar. What's the difference?
One sweet, the other salty? Does everyone have a chapter 15 handout?
Yes. You want one? No,
we've had a few new people come in, but in any case... Yeah, does anyone need one? Y'all has got them back here. Let's read chapter 15. And I know that this is going to be sort of a lengthy reading, but you really kind of have to read the entire thing to figure out what's going on.
32 verses.
Uh-huh. Chapter 15. I think these young people don't. Thanks, John. Luke chapter 15. Now all the tax collectors and the sinners were coming near him to listen to him. But the Pharisees and scribes began to grumble, saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable, saying, "What man among you, if he has 100 sheep and has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open pasture and go after the one which is lost until he finds it? When he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost.' I tell you that in the same way there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, if she has 10 silver coins and loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin which I had lost.' In the same way, I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents." And he said, "A man had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of the estate that falls to me.' So he divided his wealth between them. And not many days later, the young son gathered everything together and went on a journey into a distant country, and there he squandered his estate with loose living. Now when he had spent everything, a severe famine occurred in that country, and he began to be impoverished. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would have gladly filled his stomach with the pods that the swine were eating, and no one was giving him anything. But when he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired men have more than enough bread? But I'm dying here with hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and will say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of your hired men.' So he got up, came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion for him and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet. And bring the fattened calf. Kill it and let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and has come to life again. He was lost and has been found.' And began to celebrate. Now the older son was in the field. And when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. And he summoned one of the servants and began inquiring what these things could be. And he said to him, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fattened calf, because he's received him back safe and sound.' But he became angry. He was not willing to go in. And his father came out and began pleading with him. But he answered and said to his father, 'Look, for so many years I've been serving you, and I've never neglected a command of yours, and yet you've never given me a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your wealth with prostitutes, you killed a fattened calf for him.' And he said to him, 'Son, you have always been with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice. For this brother of yours was dead and has begun to live, and was lost and has been found.'" So, let's take a look at the context of these parables. Yes, sir?
Jesus is trying to make us aware of the value of one soul. You know, we need that lesson badly. So many times we see a brother going astray and we just let him go, or a sister. James 5:19 tells us that if a brother is straying and you bring him back, he said, you need to be aware that you have saved a soul from death and covered a multitude of sins.
Right.
Yeah. But, you know, we hear expressions like, "Well, he got what was coming to him. He deserved it. He should have known better. you know, I could have told you kind of thing.
Yeah.
That soul is more valuable than the 99 of God.
Yeah. This is
Scripture says that there's more rejoicing in heaven when one sinner repents than when 99 that don't need to repent do repent.
Well, that's right. That's right. This is a parable, basically, about the underappreciated value of the lost. And it's a lesson that we do need from time to time. I mean, these stories are actually fairly familiar. But, I don't know, somehow we don't always retain the message, I guess. But it really is important to realize that the people that we meet on the street, who in fact are lost, or the brother and sister in Christ who has wandered away, who is now lost, God thinks a lot of them. He wants them to come back. He desires that we be our brother's keeper. We need to understand just how underappreciated the value of the lost is. Taking a look at the context of these parables, because the context is important as well. Note here that the tax collectors and the sinners were coming near to listen to him. So who exactly is Jesus associating with? Tax collectors and sinners. So why were the tax collectors so despised?
Well, they were considered traitors because they were collecting taxes from the Roman government.
Right. As far as most folks were concerned, tax collectors were turncoats. They were traitors. They had turned on their own people. How could they do something like that? This is what was going through the minds of most people. And what sort of people would the sinners include?
Probably non-Pharisees.
Yeah.
Loving his common people. But.
Yeah. Perhaps one might consider them maybe, I don't know, maybe certainly the prostitutes and the gamblers and, you know, I think because the society's always had those folks, right? So, you know, think of the folks who that you know of or have heard of or read the paper or whatever you want to say who kind of fit that bill. But it also probably included the irreligious. There's always been non-churchgoers in the world. There's always been non-synagogue goers in the world. People who just, you know, I don't know. Do we have people like that around today? Oh, yeah. Farmer, the rancher, that you know, he just works his farm and his ranch, and he never goes to church. And okay, maybe he's got some religious feelings, generally speaking, but he never really does much with them. You know, he doesn't go to church or whatever. That's kind of who we're talking about here, and who the Pharisees and the scribes specifically would consider to be sinners. Now, like I said, it does include people that we would also consider sinners, you know, prostitutes or criminals or, you know, people that just weren't doing right, cheats or whatever. But in thinking about who these people were that were associated with Jesus, I think it's worthwhile kind of giving a little bit of thought to all that. Who was disapproving of Jesus' association with these people?
Pharisees.
Yeah, the Pharisees and the scribes. Who were the scribes? We know who the Pharisees are, I think.
Yes. They were the teachers of the law. We get kind of an idea of what's going on here when we go back to the story where Jesus healed the man who had been born blind. I think he was like 38 years old or something like that. Uh-huh. And the scribes kept asking him, who did this? Who did that? Anyway, he finally asked them, do you want to become his followers? And it shows their contempt for people like him. They said, you can't teach us anything. You were totally born in sin.
Yeah. Yeah, the Pharisees were people who we would, I mean, today they would might be considered among the Hasidim. If you're familiar with Jewish denominations, they're the conservative, the ultra-Orthodox. They were concerned about following all the little laws and traditions and so forth that not only that God had made, but that also some of the rabbis had made. They were interested in doing all that. The scribes in particular were pretty much what you would expect a scribe to be. What does a scribe usually?
Writes.
He writes. So what were these scribes writing most of the time?
Laws.
Yeah, they were the photocopiers of the day. Okay, they would end up taking scripture and they would copy it, and that was their job. That's what they did every day, all day. And so who in the world would possibly know the scriptures themselves better than the scribes? Well, Jesus would, of course. But nobody would know the law better than them. Why? Because they're copying it all day long. That's what they do for a living. So that's the reason why they were thinking, you were born in sin. You can't teach us anything. And so they were kind of looking down their nose at these tax collectors and sinners. What was that?
Who paid the scribes?
Anyone who wanted to buy a copy of the Bible. And usually that was pretty pricey. Because how long do you suppose it might take to copy down by hand the entire Old Testament?
How many days? 365 days.
I'm not sure exactly how long it would be, but I'm guessing I'd get writer's cramp before I got through Genesis, okay?
But
it'd take a while. Okay, let's just say, just for argument's sake, I think it'd take longer, but let's say it would take 9 months to make it through the entire, maybe a whole year, to make it through the entire Old Testament, writing it by hand. Now, how much would a Bible cost today?
Cost?
Mm-hmm. Price? Several hundreds of dollars. In today's wages.
In today's money, we're probably talking an entire year's salary. Whatever that would be.
50 grand.
Oh, I'd say closer to 70, 80, maybe even $100,000. Because these people were educated more than other folks because they knew how to write. And that was a skill back in those days. Yes, sir.
And another thing that makes it take even longer is they didn't have these nice little sheets of paper like we have.
They're all
they
scrolls.
Had the scrolls.
Yeah.
So you had to unroll the scrolls.
So you were buying, by the way, you probably would end up buying a scroll at a time, a book at a time. That's the only way that anyone could possibly afford it. Yes, sir.
How fast do the scribes work?
How fast were they?
How fast were they?
They weren't super fast, and I'll tell you why. Because they wanted to be sure that they were doing it accurately. There was something called in the ancient world a scriptorium. Scriptoriums they'd be smaller than this room, maybe about half the size of this auditorium. But you would have someone standing at a lectern like I'm standing right now. But all of these seats, actually probably about half these seats, would be filled with scribes who would have their pen, their inkwell, and their scroll, and they would be writing. Now, what the guy at the lectern would do is he would read one line, and then he would say, "Now, I want you to count how many letters you have on that line. You should have 20, 25 letters." So, as a scribe, you would go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay, I got as many letters as I'm supposed to have. Let's go to the next line. And they do it that way. How long would that take? A while. Why were they being so cautious? You're dealing with God's word. You want to make sure you've got it accurate. Which is, by the way, part of the reason why it is that we have copies of scripture that are so accurate. and why things like the Dead Sea Scrolls help us to understand just how accurate it really is. We have a copy of the book of Isaiah, for example, that probably runs back to about 200 BC. And yet, when we compare the book of Isaiah, such as we have now, to that Dead Sea Scroll, whoa, accurate. Why? Because these scribes took their work really seriously.
BC is before Christ.
That's correct.
How many centuries did it take to reach the New Testament? Now, 80 from 200 to...
The first New Testament books were probably written roughly about 55 A.D. But if we're talking about 200 B.C., we're talking about 200 years before Christ was born-ish. Somewhere in that neighborhood.
Thank you.
Welcome. So the scribes and the Pharisees ended up objecting. What were their objections? What had Jesus done? What were their objections to Jesus hanging out with the sinners and tax collectors?
Be like Jesus.
They're not one of us.
They're not one of us. You know, yes, sir, y'all.
This is my little thinking on this. Jesus is preaching. The Pharisees and the scribes rather obstructed. So it's like Jesus preaching about the kingdom. They obstructed because when you go forward, Jesus will tell them, why don't you, I'm paraphrasing, so many people are entering into the kingdom. Why don't you also enter into the kingdom? So I'm thinking, here is Jesus preaching and your question comes in. These people are doing everything to obstruct Jesus from preaching to the people. But however, Jesus says, this is what I came to this earth for. So it's like interchanging, and Jesus trying to put them off, they trying to come in. So the bottom line is, they are against the teachings of Jesus because they've already said it before in our later passages that, hey, if we allow this man to go ahead, we'll be in trouble before the Roman Emperor. So they are doing everything they can not to lose their job, if I say so. You know, so
yeah.
Pretty much so.
There's a lot of that sort of dynamic going on. The objections, very specifically to Jesus hanging out with the sinners and the tax collectors, really had a lot to do with the fact that they were looked down upon as being sinful, and this is not the kind of company that you would expect the Messiah to hang out with. He's not the kind of company that you would expect a rabbi to be hanging out with. Why?
Well, eating signifies acceptance and recognition.
Yeah.
And that bothered them.
That bothered him a lot. Why are you hanging out with these people? You know, generally speaking, you want to hang out with good people, right? Because good people are going to give you, are going to influence you to do the right thing. And is there any wisdom in that, by the way? Yeah, there is some wisdom there. There is some wisdom there. But, you know, I think it's always worthwhile. And, you know, I'm glad this is an older crowd. That is an adult-ish crowd. Because teenagers frequently don't get this, right? Well, why can't I hang out with my friends? Well, why do we tell our teenagers not to hang out with their friends? Sometimes they don't have the world's best influence, right? So is it okay for us to hang out with some of the people that are sinners and tax collectors?
Jesus is 12 years old. When he went into the temple.
But that's not exactly what we're talking about here. But really, it kind of depends on the, shall we say, the influence flow.
Influential.
Which way is the influence going?
You're right.
Right. Which direction was the influence going when Jesus was hanging out with the tax collectors and sinners?
Jesus.
From Jesus to the sinners. What's the thing that we end up fearing when we tell our teenagers not to hang out with their friends? The influence is going to be going from the friends to the kid, right? That's, yeah.
Paul even told the Corinthians that bad company corrupts good morals.
True.
What we think? That your personality is made up of the five people you hang out with the most.
Quite frequently. Yeah. All those things being said, then, they were kind of saying to a degree, why are you hanging out with these people? You ought to be hanging out with the good guys, us. So that was their biggest objection. That was the biggest problem. But it's worthwhile asking the question, would all sinners want to be received by and eat with Jesus?
Yes.
Some, probably not all of them. Why?
They weren't believers.
What was Jesus going to be preaching?
Gospel.
Righteousness. In some cases, he preaches judgment. He ends up preaching about, you know, doing the right thing and the kingdom of God is at hand and all that sort of stuff. And if you happen to be a cheat, a scam artist who really is not repentant, would you want to hang out with Jesus?
No.
Probably not. So exactly which kind of sinner would want to be received by and eat with Jesus? Some of those who perhaps were kind of tired of living the way they were living. Yeah, maybe
change of heart.
People that were having a change of heart about things.
The story of Zacchaeus is a good example of that. Zacchaeus, of course, was a tax collector. So he was considered to be a sinner and a traitor, you know, by the Pharisees. But apparently, Zacchaeus had a lot of good inner qualities. That's what attracted him to Jesus, just beyond the curiosity.
Yeah. So apparently, you know, just putting a little bit of logic to it, the kind of sinners and tax collectors that probably would be wanting to hang around Jesus and eat with him were probably the ones that were interested in what he was saying. Interested in talking about righteousness, asking questions about what is right and what is wrong. And, you know, what is the kingdom of God going to be like? And how can I get into it? Is there any way for me to be forgiven of what I've done? Yeah. Yes, sir.
The tax collectors and unbelievers, were they apostles or were they apostles around that time with Jesus?
There was one of the apostles who was a tax collector. It was Matthew. Matthew was called sitting at the tax collection table.
He was the first, right?
No, not necessarily. I think it was probably Peter and Andrew, James and John that were the first to be called. But Matthew, the point at least is
Matthew was probably the youngest.
No, John was probably the youngest of all of them.
John.
But the point at least is that these folks were probably folks that were kind of wanting to turn their lives around. So should Jesus have been hanging out with them?
No.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Because after all is said and done, these are people that are wanting to turn their lives around. So why not? And I think that's the key element here. What kind of sinner would not want to be received by Jesus? Kind of didn't want to turn around, right? And what would be the difference? As far as the Pharisees were concerned, there wasn't any difference. As far as Jesus was concerned, there was a huge difference. And that's who he was wanting to speak to. But now, starting in the next verse there, verse 3, he's going to start telling them a parable to help them understand just how terrible their attitudes were. Y'all?
So, when we go to John 3, when Nicodemus,
Yes.
When Nicodemus came to Jesus, the statement that he made, he said, all of us see that what you are the Son of God, because what you're doing, nobody can do it except you are from God.
Right.
Therefore, does it mean that, as we were saying, or Jesus said they are hypocrites, does it mean within them they know Jesus is the Son of God, but outside they pretend?
Apparently there were some people that were secret disciples. Nicodemus was one. Joseph of Arimathea was another. Apparently they were both part of the Sanhedrin, but apparently both of them were believers. Now, from time to time, Nicodemus actually did kind of come out as being a disciple of Jesus, but he got an awful lot of heat for it. There were some people, on the other hand, who, and there are people like this today, who can see all kinds of evidence that God exists. They can see all kinds of evidence that Jesus is the Christ. But you're not going to convince them. Why? They don't want to be convinced. There's an old saying, there is none so blind as he who will not see. One more comment and then we'll need to close up.
There's a song that says it's hard to be humble when you're perfect in every way.
Yes, sir.
The Pharisees thought themselves perfect in every way, so consequently, they looked down upon everybody
right.
that they thought was less perfect than they.
Right.
And that's such an easy tool that Satan uses when he puts us up here looking down on other people.
Pride is a great...
That's the story of the Jesus and the woman taken in the very act of adultery so meaningful. Mm-hmm. I mean, everybody... What was Jesus' response? They were saying, Moses said, stoner, what do you say? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And Jesus says... Okay, the one that doesn't have any sin at all, let him throw the first stone.
Yep.
You know, that turned the mirror back on each individual. And we need to turn the mirror on ourselves sometimes to realize that.
It's true.
You know.
It's true.
We got a peg or two to go yet.
It's true. Well, we need to go ahead and close because we're already behind time. But thank you for all your great comments. It was a good class. And if you happen to be joining us online, we'd like to encourage you to join us in a few minutes for our worship services today.
The church is one foundation, is Jesus Christ her Lord. She is